Hello, I'm Andrew Kelly from Bristol Ideas. Early this month, we showed The Newcomers, a BBC series from 1964 that featured a young couple, Alison and Anthony Smith. It also featured many others from Bristol at the time, including Tom Stoppard. And most of all, it featured the city of Bristol. I'm joined today by Anthony, ACH Smith. We're going to be talking about the series and what happened after. Thank you very much for joining us, ACH.
It's good to be here.
Let's start with The Newcomers. We watched it a few weeks ago on the big screen. 58 years on, what do you think about it now?
The quick answer is when I saw it this time around, I was really impressed with what Boorman has done. And Jim Saunders, his cameraman, I thought it was beautifully made. But that's my latest and current view. If you will, of course, remember, because you organised it, that about a dozen years ago, we had a showing of the same thing at Watershed. And I didn't enjoy that one much. And I was mostly embarrassed. I'm not quite sure what by, actually. I think probably our own performances, but also the sort of chutzpah of thinking anyone might be interested in all this. I didn't have those reservations this time around. I just forgot about our performances. I didn't pay any attention. I paid attention to what the camera was doing and what the film editor, mostly John Merritt, who used to live in West Shrubbery over the road, was doing. I was just admiring it filmically and thinking, oh yes, the man who made these went on to have a pretty glittering career in Hollywood. But at that time he was a blue-eyed boy of BBC documentaries.
I want to come back to Boorman and some of the others involved in a moment. But clearly there is interest in this film because on both occasions we've shown it, we've sold out. And I know there's been talk about releasing the series alongside other of John Boorman's work on DVD, for example, some of his early work. And we'd certainly like to show more of this. Well, there were members of the family in the audience and also some of the other people in the film, like Derek Barmer, for example. Yep. What did they think of it?
Nobody said a bad word about it to me afterwards, and lots of people said a good word to me about it. I had the impression it went down very well. I mean, we had a fairly sustained applause at the end. Now, you know, whether they were clapping us or clapping you for having the imagination to put this, make it available to the public, or whether they were clapping the city of Bristol, I don't know. One of the nice responses was when we first showed it a dozen years ago at Watershed, with a brief intro from me and an interval, the whole thing's 4 hours. And Helen Holland, who was, and I think still maybe, I'm not sure, leader of the Labour Party in Bristol. So clearly a woman with plenty on her plate, and also a woman I like and to whom I am very distantly related, she tells me, by three marriages, and, you know, step this and... I caught her at the end. She was there, sat all through the 4 hours. This is the first time we showed it. And I thought I ought to say, I'm sorry for keeping you so long, Helen. And she said, I'd have been very happy sitting here till midnight. And I interpret that as meaning how patriotic she is about the city of Bristol and how much she saw of what Bristol was and mostly still is to this day. And, you know, I think that's why we got a sustained applause at the end this time. It's people feeling, I love Bristol and I like the picture that John Boorman gave me of it.
Let's talk about Boorman and some of the other people involved. I mean, you mentioned John Boorman's glittering rise. I mean, it was a remarkable rise, wasn't it? He made The Newcomers 63, 64, the year after Catch Me If You Can with the Dave Clark Five, 2 years later in Hollywood making films with Lee Marvin.
I wrote a memoir that came out about 10 years ago, and in it I said that when I watched Point Blank for the first time, it was like watching the bowler who last Saturday took 0-for-80 against Ned Thrubwell's second 11 bowl out the West Indians at Lord's. I mean, it was, to me, inexplicable, actually. I won't say entirely unexpected, because he was a very, you know, ambitious and committed filmmaker, so he knew he was going somewhere. But nevertheless, the quality of Point Blank is a wonderful film, beautifully made, and I was just bowled over by it.
Tell us about what the BBC was like at the time, because he was head of documentaries, I think, for BBC West as it existed then.
Yes.
And he'd already made a series called Citizen 63, which we hoped to show at some point. Someone came up to me after the showing on Saturday and said they were in a film with Boorman as a young girl called The Sculpture, which I'm now looking into for her.
Find it, Andrew, find it. It's a gem. It created a stir at the time. It's a little bit risque.
Right. Well, we'll look into that and see if we can get that one shown as well. But what was the BBC like then? Because, you know, were they regarded as great innovators at that time?
No. Boorman always said that they looked askance at him when he was appointed. I mean, he'd been working for Southern TV in Southampton and then got this job. And he said that there were people looking out of the corner of their eyes at him, thinking he was not quite the kind of chap that we're used to employing in the corporation. And I had a bit of a taste of that myself at one time, which I won't go into, it's my story, but that didn't worry him, because he was always going to be a lone rider. And he came in with the ambition of doing exactly what he did, which was to create a new television for the BBC. And I can't pretend to be a television historian, you're probably better at that than I am, but I don't think anyone before in any channel had made the kind of films that Citizen 63 were, which were films about ordinary people. I mean, the audience, the TV audience, was used to only seeing people they already knew about. And suddenly here were complete strangers, and we were asked to be interested in them for 30 minutes. And it caught on, and, you know, it led to The Newcomers, you know, much longer, six-part series.
And there were many, other people involved in the film, and I was, the morning we showed it, I led a little walk around Bristol showing people some of the sights in The Newcomers, and also talked about some of the people involved, and certainly some of the people involved, like, for example, George Brandt at the University of Bristol, who...
He's a wonderful man.
And quite, I think, really quite significant man in terms of theatre as well, and George, film.
Oh, George, within his very large head, had, I think, the history of European theatre. I mean, for instance, he'd written a book on 18th century theatre in Holland. Pretty recherché subject, I'll agree. But George knew it. George knew, he was a fabulously learned man, but he was also a man who was immensely generous in sharing what was in his head. He was a natural teacher. He just loved to share information and steer people in directions that he thought they would be interested in going.
And one of the people, I mean, there's many people we can talk about in the film, but one I focused on particularly was I took people to Gordon Road and showed them where Val Lorraine lived. And she's a very significant figure, isn't she, in Bristol theatre, but much unknown.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, she'd been a professional actress since wartime. She was in Bristol. I think she probably came to Bristol to work for the BBC in the war, and she was an announcer, a radio continuity announcer, and, you know, doing the jobs they do, weather and that kind of thing. And she, like so many of us, succumbed to the fatal charms of Bristol and couldn't get away, and so stayed here. She went on acting a bit. She never had a big, flashy career, but she got some work. But she and her husband, Bob Lorraine, who was one of three brothers who ran a building firm, acquired this gorgeous little Georgian house just behind the student union in, I've forgotten the name of the road now. Names are getting difficult. It doesn't matter. And she would occasionally take a lodger. She wasn't running a boarding house, but she would occasionally, she got a room and she would let it out if there was somebody who wanted somewhere to stay for a bit. And, you know, and that's where Tom was. Tom found that. And she was charging him £2 a week, and that included supper most evenings. And I once said to her, years later, I said, Val, £2 a week, even in the late 50s and early 60s, including a meal, is ridiculous, you know. And she said, I just thought he might have it in him to become a good writer. And I remember I said, I wish you'd gone to Ladbrokes and put a couple of quid on him at that point. But Val was in effect the mother of actors in Bristol. Her house was the mecca for them. I think there's probably one of these in most big cities with a theatre company, but Val was the one in Bristol. Hence, in 1962, Peter O'Toole, having just made Lawrence of Arabia, suddenly turned up at Val's house one lunchtime, and of course she was delighted to see him. And he said, there's so many people in Bristol I want to catch up with, and I haven't got much time. I think the only answer is for me to hold a party and invite them all. And Val said, oh, that's a good idea, Peter. And he said, can I have it here? And she said, yeah, sure, of course. He said, this evening, all right? And suddenly, you know, the requisites for a party, food and drink and phone calls to invite people and put the word around, you know. And we had, I was involved. In fact, I was, O'Toole enlisted me as a taxi driver for a while. We had this party, and a lot of things happened at that party, some of which I put in my memoir. But the one I can recount in public is that at about 3 a.m, the party was still going, and there was a very nice looking girl from Lebanon there who looked at her watch and said, oh, it's late, I must get home to St. Paul's. Can I get a taxi? And O'Toole said, I'll give you a lift, I've got a car here, jump in. So she jumped in, and they were driving from Clifton to St. Paul's, and O'Toole was going down Park Street, but having just spent the best part of a year, I think it was, in America and Spain, making Lawrence of Arabia. And after a long party, with I expect the odd glass, he wasn't quite sure whether he should drive on the left-hand side or the right-hand side of the road. So he did what he thought was a very sensible thing, which is to split the difference. he started going down Park Street on one side and then switched to the other side, thinking, you know, he'd get it half right. And a police car observed this maneuver with interest, and he wound up in the cells for the night. And when he says, I think he made this up, but he says that when he said to the duty sergeant who was booking him in, he said, I'm Peter O'Toole. And the duty sergeant said, that's funny, we had that Laurence Olivier in here only last week. And O'Toole was up in court at 11 that morning. I didn't know cases could happen that quickly. Maybe it's if you're a very famous actor, they like to get rid of you. I don't know. But he was up in court at 11 that morning and banned from driving for, I think, about 3 months he got, you know. This left him stuck in Bristol with his new Mini, when Minis were the car to have, you know, the cutting edge of fashion and style, to have a Mini, and of course O'Toole had one. And he had to leave it in Bristol. So he asked me if I would take care of it while until the next time I could find time to drive it to Bristol. And I said I was delighted, and I managed to find that it was quite impossible for me to get to London for another 2 weeks. Meanwhile, I was zipping around Bristol in a Mini. And then I finally delivered it to his house in Hampstead. That came out of that party. Sorry, well, we've got off Val Lorraine. I mean, Val Lorraine was the fairy godmother for the theatrical industry in Bristol. And she was a lovely, warm woman. And Tom has remained grateful to her all his life since. When she was within days of dying, she was in a care home over just the other side of the suspension bridge from Clifton. And Tom came to see her, and it was interesting. I went in with him because I knew Val well. And we talked to Val for a while and then went out for a fag in those days. And then Tom said, I think I'll just go back for a moment on my own. And he stayed about 15, 20 minutes. And I didn't mind because it was obvious to me that he mattered so much to Val that he had to spend that time with just the two of them together at the end. And she died within days.
I think it's one of those stories about Bristol. I mean, it's not covered in the film and she's not mentioned in the film, but she played such an important role in the lives of many people. We've always wanted to do a project called Val's House, in fact, which looks at the people who stayed there and the people she supported and the parties she had and so on. I mean, with other people, I mean, there's so many people we could talk about in Newcomers, but I like you, I was watching the film this time, particularly to watch Boorman's filmmaking. And it really struck me how already...
Sorry, Andrew, go back. You froze for a moment and I lost some words. You were saying, like you, I watched the film.
Okay, I'll run that again, Zoe. I'll start again, yeah? Like you, I watched The Newcomers this time specifically to watch Boorman's filmmaking techniques. And clearly he was deeply versed in things like the French New Wave, new British cinema of the time. It keeps coming through time and time again. But what really brought it home to me was just the sheer quality of the filmmaking that was pretty consistent across all six episodes, really.
Well, right. That's what gave me most pleasure this time around, watching that. I said somewhere, I mean, Jim Saunders was the main cameraman. There were one or two others, but he was the lead cameraman, if there was such a position. And Boorman, you know, fancied he knew his way around a film camera and the lighting. And he really admired Jim Saunders' work. And he he said to me, he said, Jim has a way of lighting a scene which follows no rules whatever, and yet it's always terrific. And I study what he does for myself and try and work out what he's doing and how does he do it. I still don't understand. He's a law unto himself.
And the other thing which came through to me, I mean, it's come through to me before when I've watched the series, is the music in it. And it was, I think, David Lee, was it, who was the musician?
You've frozen again, Andrew. I'm sorry.
Okay. Let me just try and bring Zoe in. Zoe, is there a problem, do you think?
Oh, you're both fine for me. So I wonder whether it might be ACH's connection.
Maybe the Wi-Fi is not strong enough. I don't know.
But don't worry, because I can click these little bits out.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, you were just leading into music.
Oh, come on, I'll do the question again, Anthony. Yeah. And there were many other things in the film which I'll do that one again. Sorry. Another thing which really struck me this time round, though I've enjoyed it very much before, was the role of the music plays in the film, both the kind of theme tune that goes throughout all six episodes, but also the jazz music that appears. And it was it a composer called Dave Lee, a musician called Dave Lee?
Yeah, it's interesting that. I mean, in my introduction, when we showed the films at the Arnold Feeney the other day, I quoted Boorman as saying, he depends on accidents. The best things in his films, he thinks, are always accidents. That music's an accident. We'd been asked by friends to look after a clavichord for, it turned out to be the best part of a year. You know, and what's that, an 18th century keyboard twangy thing. A lovely noise, but, you know, not the sort of things that people like us at that time would normally have around their house. But there it was. Well, Alison plays the piano, so she knows her way around a keyboard. And she found some music somewhere by John Dowland, a Tudor era composer. And one of them was Melancholy Galliard, and she liked it and started rehearsing it on this clavichord. And it sounded, you hear her in the film, it sounded lovely. And Boorman heard her playing this, and that became the theme tune to the Newcomers, but rearranged by Dave Lee with, you know, saxophones and things that John Dowland knew nothing of. And I think it works extremely well. But it would have been something entirely different if it hadn't been for the accident of that clavichord being there and Alison having the Dowland to play.
When I did the walk around Bristol with the group, I told them some of the stories from the film and showed them some of the pictures that we'd managed to find of Bristol at the time. And there were two that really struck a chord with them. The first was when we stood outside 59 Prince Street and I told them the story about the pen and the dock workers waving their books to get work. And we talked a little bit then about how precarious labour is these days for some people. But of course then, it was probably even worse, that kind of labour.
You know, I've got scenes about this in the play I did for the Bristol Vic about the docks up the feeder down the mouth. I talked to dockers and got a pretty good impression of how things were. In fact, thanks to Boorman, Boorman reckons he was the first and possibly remained the only film crew allowed ever to film what actually went on, because everyone, the dockers, but the stevedores prancing around up there, and probably the Docks Labour Board themselves, you know, who employed them, was ashamed of the system. They all thought it was a dreadful system, but nobody had managed to figure out a better system. And what the dockers all told me, in fact, it was corrupt because it was riddled with favoritism. 500 men would pack in, how many of them were going to get a job that day depended on how busy the dock was. Monday was always the busiest day of the week. Some days ships were moored 3 deep along the waterfront near where the Lloyds Bank area is now, facing Hampshire. Other days it would be quieter and not many people would get a job. And you got a job by crowding in there, and it's not a big space for 500 people, crowding in there with your black book to show you a registered dock worker. And you held up your book and the stewards would prance up and down saying, you. And according to the dockers, 9 times out of 10, they were just choosing their favorites, you know, possibly their second cousin or something. It was a very corrupt and unfair system. And the way the dockers talked about it was, oh, if you want to earn a decent living, you've got to be one of the blue eyes. And I wrote a song for my show called Blue Eyes, Blue Eyes. Your eyes are so blue, the stevedore's taken a fancy to you. I won't sing it for you. You wouldn't.
You'd be very welcome. The other story which I told them was how the job you'd in fact just left or left recently in the film, which was you running the arts page at the Western Daily Press.
Yeah.
And not only did I tell them that that arts page existed, that it was full broadsheet size, yeah, not tabloid, yeah. Yeah. And that it covered the kind of areas that, you know, the top quality Sunday review sections would cover.
Well, that was a reflection of what Tom was co-edited with. He wasn't employed, but in effect, we jointly edited that page. I mean, that reflected what we were interested in, but most of all, it reflected what Richard Hawkins was interested in. Richard, the evening, just give me just a minute of Bristol newspaper history here. In the 1930s, the Northcliffe Press were taking over as much of the provincial press as they could, including in Derby, nearly your native city. And suddenly they were onto Bristol. They were going to buy up everything that called itself a newspaper in Bristol, and that would be Northcliffe. And well, a group of two people. One was the Bishop of Malmesbury. I'm not quite sure how he got involved, but he did. And the other one was Walter Hawkins. And they said, you know, this isn't good enough. We don't know about Derby and Newcastle and Chester, you know, but Bristol is an independent city and will not have the Northcliffe Group running its papers. Things, of course, in 2022 are now very different, but that's a different subject. This was in the 1930s. So they started the Bristol Evening Post, which used to have the subtext, the paper all Bristol asked for and helped to create. And within 2 years, they were doing so well that they bought out the paper Northcliffe had started, the Bristol Evening World. Now, it was then the case that the Bristol Evening Post vastly outsold the Bristol Evening World. But the Bristol Evening World, where Tom worked for a while, and people like David Foote and, I could name a lot of very good and well-known journalists, including a man whose name I can't remember, who went on to edit the Times. The Bristol Evening World was a very well-written, well-laid-out paper with very little money, but it was shrewdly spent. The Bristol Evening Post, I have to tell you, which I came to Bristol to work for, that was my first job. I was a trainee sub-editor on the Bristol Evening Post. Was not a vastly entertaining paper, I have to say. It was a kind of stuffy mouthpiece for the establishment. But Walter Hawkins' son, Richard, who was designated, because he was his son, to take over the family business eventually, but didn't, because his only interest was music. He wanted to be a composer. And so he left in the end to go into the music business. Richard had, you know, tastes like Tom and I had, and a lot of people had. We sold 2,000 copies more every, initially it was Wednesday, and then it became Monday, the day the arts page came out, than on other days of the week. And there's no other explanation. It was the only different thing in the paper. So we were selling 2,000 copies of the arts page. And of course, more that people who didn't buy it for that purpose nevertheless read it. And I'd like to think we made a difference. You know, we published poems by Ted Hughes, and I could go on. And that's why it looked different. The editor of, by this time I'd been moved from the Bristol Evening Post across the Western Daily Press, because it was now under, all under the same ownership. I'd been moved on to the paper, and soon after that, Richard said, I'd like to start an arts page and I'd like you to edit it. And that's how it happened. It only survived for about 2.5 years because an extremely philistine editor, I'll name him Eric Price, because a lot of people will remember him, took over and did wonders in increasing the circulation of the paper. I mean, when it was first taken over by the Evening Post at its own request, I mean, the Western Daily Press went to the Evening Post and said, if you don't take us over, we're done for, we'll fold. So the Evening Post, you know, it was an old paper, the Western Daily Press, Victorian origins, took it over. And it was selling so few copies at that time, including when it was employing a young journalist called Tom Stoppard, that the rev counter on the printing machine was covered with tape so that nobody except the man running the printing machine knew how few copies were coming off. And Eric Price made a huge difference. I mean, suddenly the graph went up and up and up and up. But of course, that meant his power went up and up. And after about 2.5 years, he was in a position to smash the arts page to smithereens.
It was a terrible tragedy, yeah, because
people still remember it, because we published some good stuff. I won't say everything in it, but you know, there were some good things that we did. That's how I met Tom. Richard Hawkins said, there's a young journalist called Tom Stoppard you might give some work to. And I'd met Tom once, and he met me once, the same meeting. We hadn't liked the look of each other at all, but I gritted my teeth and invited him to write a piece on any subject he chose, really. And he said, oh, I'll write something on the new wave in French cinema. I thought, I have my work cut out. I'll be editing that when it comes in. And when it came in, I didn't change a comma. It was beautiful.
Yeah.
And I thought, who is this? And that's how our friendship began.
Well, one of the most enjoyable moments I've had was going through your complete page clippings from that time. You know, you have your enormous folder full of them, and very kindly let me take a look at them at some point. Let's move on to the follow-up. There was 10 years later, there was a program called Deadly Serious Smith, which was made by Colin Rose at the BBC. What did you think about that as a program? I always took that as being slightly more tongue-in-cheek, to be honest, the times I've seen it.
It was written by me with my tongue in my cheek. Because of the difficult experience that we, Alison and I, and I think maybe Tom, went through on making the Boorman films. You know, you won't misunderstand me. I wouldn't want anyone watching this to misunderstand me. It was a fantastic opening for us, an opportunity, and it led to probably the rest of my life, you know, in terms of openings for work. But it was very difficult. on a personal level, it put great pressure on us. And so when, I mean, Boorman by this time had moved off to Hollywood and was the big Hollywood director. And when Colin Rose, who was an old friend, he'd been a contemporary of Alison's when they were students at the university. When Colin, by now working for the BBC, said he'd like to make a Where Are They Now film. It wasn't just us. That one, he did, I think, six on six subjects that John Boorman had filmed. Where Are They Now 10 years on after, you know, so you can see how the films work. You show a few clips from 10 years ago and where they are now. And that was the interest of the film. And in our case, I knew Colin very well, and I could talk very honestly with him. And I said, well, I'd like at least one element of the film that I do with you to just raise a few questions about the kind of documentary filming that Boorman was doing at that time. Only raise questions, not a sale, not at all. I mean, you and I have already talked about The Newcomers. It's a wonderful film, I think. But it does raise questions. And so I raised those questions. By the way, I said to Colin, and the other deal is I write this film. Boorman effectively wrote The Newcomers. Technically, I was one of the screenwriters, but I didn't really. I said, all right. So I wrote Deadly Serious Smith. And it was meant to be, you know, a bit of a wink to the viewer about, you know what's going on, really, don't you? Which is me playing this kind of meta game of I'm the subject of the film, but actually I'm writing this film, you know. Nudge, nudge. It was that kind of tone that we adopted, and I hope we got away with it, but I did that on purpose to add a bit of perspective to the people watching The Newcomers.
And did Boorman see Deadly Serious Smith, do you know?
I don't know, but I doubt it. I mean, once he left Bristol and moved off to, well, he lives in Ireland now. I'm not sure where, he probably moved to London to start with. We didn't see anything of him. Well, occasionally, he came back once or twice, I think once at your invitation.
Yes.
But he was occasionally to be spotted in Bristol, but he didn't have any enduring, committed interest in the city anymore.
Yeah. I mean, we certainly did bring him back when we showed The Newcomers that more than a decade ago, and he did sit through the first episode of The Newcomers, and he said, well, something like, that wasn't as bad as I feared, something like that, I think, was his response. But I think that's a fairly common response that people talk about when they look back at their work. I didn't realise, actually, that Deadly Serious Smith was a series. I thought it was a one-off. And were the other films that were made about Bristolian characters or just others that Boorman had covered?
About other characters in Boorman's Citizen 66.
Right, series. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, one of the key things about The Newcomers to me is about making your way as a writer in Bristol, making your living as a writer. And, you know, the joke is, of course, that your rental on the Paragon building you were in was something like £4 a week, which when you say that to people now, they chuckle at and think, well, you know, that's very cheap and so on. I suspect that you didn't earn a lot more than that at the time.
I was earning 15 quid a week at the paper when I was still a journalist.
Yeah.
So it was a quarter of my income, which is about what you're supposed to pay in rent, yeah, isn't it?
Absolutely. Unlike now, where it's often higher than that, I hear. But you over the years, you've published many other books, including novelizations of films, a crime series, which I want to come on to. You've also kept up with some journalism, haven't you, including cricket journalism through the years. I mean, how difficult has it been? I was going to say how easy, but I can't believe it was easy at all. How difficult has it been to to make that living through those decades?
It never was easy, but I think every freelance would agree that, as Boorman says about films, you depend on accidents. You look back and you see how by doing A, that led you to do B, and then that naturally went into C, and, you know, but there's no way you could start at the beginning and say, I'll do A and get then B and then C. You just do what you can, you do your best, hope that people take notice and that somebody's in a position to say, come and work for me, you know. Not full time, you know, you're not looking for a job, you're looking for one assignment, or, you know, maybe in the case of the Newcomers, a year long, but that's how it works. And so it can get a bit, you know, when you look at your latest bank statement. I was always miles overdrawn, but I had banks in those days were very different from banks now. I mean, I had a local bank manager called Mr. Adams. We never addressed each other by first names, but we got on extremely well. He knew I owed the bank always, you know, upwards of 2,000 quid, which, I mean, in those days was a lot more than it sounds now. But he also knew me personally and understood my plan of action, how life would work on the principles I was describing just now, that one thing would lead to another and suddenly you have a breakthrough. And you do. I suddenly, probably about three times in my life, I had a real breakthrough and suddenly all my financial problems had gone. Didn't mean forever, but they, you know, for a while you could breathe easily. Meanwhile, you're raising a family. But one thing that helped is that Alison was almost always in some kind of employment. She was an actress for a while. Well, of course, not paid very much because, you know, the word actress gives the game away, but enough to help with what I was earning. And then she became a school teacher in Warmley for 15 years. And of course, then that life was much easier. But it never was easy until, well, the turning point was a phone call in 1997, I think it was. No. Hold on, I've got to think this through. Yeah, no, it was earlier than that. 1989. I was, one of my jobs at that time, I was doing a day a week going to Bournemouth and talking about documentary films to the students in Bournemouth. And I got back one day and the phone rang and a voice said, Anthony, it's Zulf. Zulf was Zulfikar Ghosh, very old friend, one of my very oldest friends, who I'd known when we were all living in London. Well, I'd been living in Bristol for about 30 years, 40 years by this time, and Zulf was in Texas, at the University of Texas, teaching creative writing. And he said, Anthony, there's a post visiting writer coming up in the department very soon. I think you should apply for it if you would like to. And I said, wow, Zulf, that's a big thing. I mean, you know, all the way to Texas and I've got a family here. And he said, well, think about it, but don't take very long because there's about 100 people applying for it. And I put the phone down and I remember I had three thoughts. One was he told me what I'd be paid. And I realized that I'd be quite a bit ahead of the bank by the time I finished. Secondly, I like a warm climate and Texas had the reputation of being that. And the third thing was it got me out of Mrs. Thatcher's England. And I rang Zulfie back I think about 10 seconds after I put the phone down and I said, "Zulf, it's Anthony." "Yes." And that changed my, and I had a lovely time in Texas. I went full of doubts about, as most writers are, doubts about whether you can teach creative writing, even though that's what the course is called. But I found what you can do. And one of the things you can do is you can teach people to read. You can work with them on writers that I admire, like Hemingway and Tom, and Flannery O'Connor, one of their locals, and so forth. And you can show them how Hemingway shapes this story in this way and how economically he works. He doesn't need a lot of words, hardly any adverbs, you know. And that helps them. And occasionally, you know, I know for a fact that a few of the students I encountered, who are almost all very nice to know, very good fun as well, a few of them have gone on and made something of a living out of writing. So I'm glad that happened. So that was a big turning point, not to go on about this. What were the other two big turning points? One, the second was the Bristol Vic, Up the Feeder, Down the Mouth, which, thanks mostly to Andy Hay, who never got the credit that he deserved, had a very successful run in the theatre. But then when it was revived 4 years later on the waterfront at the docks, it was sold out before the first night because people, the word had gone around from that first run in the theatre. I've had three, you know, what that character on telly would call nice learners that have suddenly come up. None of them, you know, as I say, me sitting here calculating, I know I'll go and write a best-selling play for the Bristol Vic. I know I'll go to Texas and teach creative writing. They happen. A phone call comes in and suddenly a new yellow brick road opens up in front of you. Okay, the third break I had was to do with Jim Henson, much loved from The Muppets. And much loved by me, he was a very, very sweet, kind man and lovely to work for because he was kind and helpful and listened to your arguments and occasionally respected them, but also had a firm idea about, you know, what was right and wrong. And unlike most film companies, the book of the film mattered to him. It wasn't just a cynical ripoff to get a few more dollars out of the punters. So he read my manuscripts and sat me down to lunch and talked me through the manuscripts and so forth. So I did, the first one I did was The Dark Crystal, which for some reason became huge in Japan, which I don't understand, but it did. But it went to number three on the New York Times bestseller list. Well, of course it wasn't my book really. It was my translation, as it were, into novel form of what Jim and his colleagues had done. Nevertheless, it meant my name at number three on the New York Times bestseller list, so I wasn't going to complain about that. And then 2 years later, I had a phone call here from Jane Leventhal, who headed up Henson Publishing, or whatever they were called. And she said, "Anthony, we got Jim's making another film. This one's called Labyrinth. We got David Bowie acting in it, along with some of the puppets. And we'd like you to do the book. Would that be all right with you?" And I, "Yeah, thank you." So we talked through what would entail, which meant going to New York for a few weeks. And then she said, now let's see. I'm just checking my files. When you did The Dark Crystal for us, we paid you $17,000. Does that sound the right kind of figure?" And I was saying, "Yes, thank you very much, Jane." And then she said, no, hold on. Let's make it $19,000. I don't know what prompted her. I wasn't, you know, going, I think what must have prompted her is I didn't say anything. She said 17,000. And I went silent in wonder at the thought that, oh, my financial problems for the next couple of years have just evaporated in one telephone call. So I didn't say anything, just smiled quietly to myself. And she probably thought I was going, oh, 17, not sure about that. So that was my third big break.
The final little bit of this interview I just wanted to talk to you about links to Up the Feeder, Down the Mouth, and also other elements of your work, including the new novel, which you've just published, which I'd like you to talk a little bit about, which is the rootedness of your work in Bristol. You know, whether it's, you know, the history of the docks and right up to the present day with your new crime novel, which is set in Bristol. I mean, Bristol is really important to you, isn't it?
Absolutely. It's a sort of political thing, really, Andrew. I think if I had to write in a box political affiliation, I think I'd write localist now. Localist with a socialist tinge. But I think localism is part of socialism. I have real doubts nowadays, as I think many people do, about the possibility of running countries certainly as big as Russia or the USA. But even the UK, I mean, we have a totally incompetent government at the moment. They can't manage it. But even the competent governments we've had have barely managed it. And I think local government, people being responsible for the way their own local city or town or village is run, is really the way forward, the only way that's going to work in the long run. And so that's enhanced the love that I have for Bristol that a lot of people who live here have, because it's a great place to live and in places very beautiful as well. So I don't see any point really in setting it. You know, I could easily set it in Isleworth on the Thames where I grew up, but there's no point because I don't belong there anymore and I don't know what goes on there nowadays. I know something of what goes on in Bristol. And, you know, you need that stuff. And it's very interesting. And again, I think it's Hemingway who says something on these lines. It is Hemingway. It's when you know something and deliberately leave it out, that stimulates the audience's imagination. When you leave something out because you don't know it, the audience sniff a rat and think, oh, he's not up to the mark, you know? And there's always a difference. And so, you know, I wouldn't say I know Bristol. That would be an absurdly arrogant thing to say, but I've lived here 60 years now, and I feel I know a good deal about the city, including its history, which, of course, is becoming, you know, thanks to people like David Olusoga, is becoming more and more prominent in the minds of many, many people who live here.
I mean, one of the things that I, when I read the new novel, for which many congratulations, you know, it's
thank you.
It's quite an achievement to write a book, let alone after, you know, writing so many and in your 80s, and I take my metaphorical hat off to you. But the way you rooted that in Bristol, you know, even to the explanation that one of the characters gives about why White Ladies Road is called White Ladies Road and why Black Boy Hill is called Black Boy Hill. I thought it was weaved in throughout in a really good way.
Yeah, well, I heard Iris Murdoch give a talk in the Great Hall of the University, probably in 1960-something. And she said that whenever she started writing one of the many novels she wrote, she said she never really knew the story. What she did was she knew the characters. She knew the three or four people who were going to be prominent in the story. And she said, the other thing I need to know is the location, the place where this story is going to happen. And I wrote the book like that, really. I mean, I knew the lead characters because I'd already used them in two previous thrillers. So they were all friends and I know how they think and talk. And the location here it is. You know, I live here, so that's why I deliberately, I wouldn't have dreamed of setting it anywhere else.
And have you got plans for a fourth volume or a new novel?
Maybe. Some writers finish a book and they already have got the seeds starting of the next one. And that has happened to me in the past, but at the moment I don't know what, well, I do know what comes next, just very soon, probably in this month, April. I've got a second pamphlet of poems coming out, because I started as a poet, as so many of us did. I've gone on writing some poetry now and then, and Tom says he likes what I write and has encouraged me to keep going. So I think of him as sort of Ezra Pound to my G.S. Eliot. Or maybe the other way around. That is what comes next, but it's done. You know, it's with the printer at the moment, so it'll be out soon. After that, I really don't know. I've got three plays completed, waiting to be done. But, you know, the theatres are still trying to get over COVID. And the current regime at the Bristol of it doesn't seem to have much time for what I've written in the past. So, but that's changing soon. We'll get a new director in and we'll see what happens then. But as for books, I mean, I can always write I like writing books very much, because you do it on your own at home, you know. But I haven't got an idea at the moment. But they're like, you know, dandelion seeds in May when the wind's blowing, and suddenly the dandelion seeds, suddenly one lands on you, and you think, oh, no. Hold on, because when I started this latest thriller, all I knew was what R.S. Murdoch, I'd forgotten. It was only when I finished the book and I said, hold on, I've done what R.S. Murdoch told me to do, but I'd forgotten that she told me, which I didn't know the plot. I just knew the people and the location, and that I wanted to write something about the cocaine racket, because I know nothing about, I've never seen a bag of cocaine in my life, but I had a curiosity. I know that most people, if they suddenly feel the need for cocaine, will go down some back street with a tenner and buy a bag. But you read about these parties, well, you're on telly and films, you see these parties where very swish, well-off bankers, you know, suddenly going like that. And you think, well, okay, I'm not going to do that. But how do they get it? I mean, whoever supplies it, presumably mine hosts at whatever party is going on, has a source. And he's not going down a back street he must have some kind of wholesale supplier of some sort. And so I came up with this probably very fanciful idea that you might be able to set up a mail order system for selling cocaine in bulk, with all sorts of safeguards, of course, to prevent the long arm reaching out and fingering your collar.
Well, that book's out now from Tangent Books, and you can still get copies of Anthony's memoir, Wordsmith, from Redcliffe Press. Anthony, thank you so much for joining us. I have to say that you know that the Newcomers is really important to us, not just in showing it, but also in helping us learn about Bristol. And we've used it many times in our work. But also thank you for the magical moments you've given us in theatre, including that wonderful night in 2001 down on the city docks when I saw the opening night of Up the Feeder, Down the Mouth.
Good. It was a
beautiful evening. And a magical moment, series of moments, the best play I've seen in Bristol in all my time here. So thank you very much for all your work, Anthony, and thank you for joining us today. Thank you very much.
It's been a great pleasure, Andrew, and thank you.